Hello, wonderful people. My name is Carol Vay and welcome back to my channel. This week, I was kind of behind on these YouTube videos and trying to figure out what I might want to talk about this week. And I found myself getting up one morning kind of discouraged because of how busy I am in every aspect of my life right now. And this usually will cause me to get discouraged or become anxious. But right away, the Lord put the joy of the Lord on my heart. And even as I was going to get my coffee or opening the curtains, even though it was dark outside so that I could watch the sunrise, I thought to myself, wow, this is joy. Getting to sit here and spend time with the Lord, enjoying a cup of coffee, watching the sunrise. And I thought, this is the kind of thing that all this busyness and discouragement cannot take away. I've learned over the years that happiness can be dictated by what's going on in your life. And with everything that's happening in the world right now, it would be really easy for so many of us to be unhappy. But joy isn't something that can be dictated by outside events. It's something that we have in our heart. And the joy of the Lord is something that I'm just so, so grateful for. Usually after work, my husband and I go for a walk outside, and all summer we've been saying, why don't we ever get our bikes down and go bike riding? We hadn't even had them out at all this whole summer. So yesterday after work, even though it was kind of a hassle, we got the bikes down and went for a bike ride instead of a walk. And it just was really, really fun and something that took a little bit of extra doing, but it was just good all the way around. And it reminded me about that special story about those two bikes that we have. Several years ago, our church was holding a fundraiser and we bought raffle tickets for a beach cruiser, and I ended up winning the bike, which I never win anything. And then it wasn't even the same year, it was like the next year or 2 years later, we did the same thing and Darren won his bike. So that in itself was such a coincidence. We never really wanted to ride those bikes on the street, but we would put them on a bike rack on the back of our car and drive about 20 miles to come up to Oceanside and get on this bike trail that goes from about 5 miles inland all the way to the beach. And we'd ride that full 10 miles back and forth and then load the bikes back on the car and go back home. Well, in 2014, when we moved to Oceanside, we walked into a house that we totally fell in love with and ended up buying it. And we found out that right around the corner from our new house was an entrance right onto that bike trail. So our bikes and our location, I feel like we're totally a gift from God. And it just brings a big smile to my face to even remember this story. One of my favorite books in the Bible that talks a lot about joy is the book of Philippians. And it's actually a letter that Paul wrote to the church of Philippi while he was in prison. And he mentions joy 16 times in this book. The background on the book of Philippians can be found in Acts chapter 16, where it talks about how Paul ended up in Philippi, how he met Lydia and the ladies down by the river, how he was arrested and beaten and thrown into jail, and how one night while Paul and Silas were singing worship and praising God, an earthquake happened and all the cell doors came open, and the guard in the jail was actually going to kill himself until Paul said that all of the prisoners were still there. Well, wouldn't you know it, the prison guard and his entire family were saved because of that. Well, after Paul was released from jail, he had to leave Philippi, and he ended up back in Rome where he was in prison when he wrote this letter. You see, one of the men from the church in Philippi, Epaphroditus, had brought Paul a monetary gift all the way to Rome, which is like an 800-mile trip. And he was writing this letter to thank them for that and to just minister to them. Paul starts this letter in chapter 1 by remembering his friends in his prayers. He says, I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Paul teaches us how to pray in this passage, but in this whole chapter, he also teaches us perspective because he's in prison, but he's looking at the effect that he's having on the prison guards as well as other Christians who are becoming more confident in speaking out because of what Paul's been through. It's kind of like when we go through something and share our experience, it helps other people too. He says in chapter 1, verse 12, "Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel." What Paul shares here might even minister to many of you who feel like you're prisoners in whatever the situation is that you're in right now, whether it's working remotely, feeling isolated, whether it's a job situation, finances, family, relationships. But if we can get our perspective right, like Paul did, we might see that we can grow from the situation and look at it with a different viewpoint, or see how we can move forward and find joy in that situation or change it if necessary. Even though Paul had been beaten and put in jail, he still rejoiced all through this book. And he even went on to say that whether he lives and continues to do the work of the ministry, or whether he goes home to be with Jesus, either way, it's great. In fact, in verse 21, he says, "For me, to live is Christ and to die is gain." He goes on to say, "If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is the better by far, but it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body." In the second chapter, Paul talks about being humble, and he also shows how Jesus was the best role model of this when he came to earth in human form. He says, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others." This totally goes against what the world would teach us, always to look out for number one. He goes on to say, "In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the Lord, to the glory of God the Father." As part of God's plan from the very, very beginning, he sent Jesus, or the part of him that would become flesh, to the earth. So Jesus left the comfort of heaven to come to earth and have all of the same feelings and pain that a human would have. And he showed us how to live. He even washed his disciples' feet when they had that Last Supper, which would be one of the most humbling acts of service a person could do. In chapter 3, Paul moves on to a warning, a testimony, and a goal. He says, "Watch out for those dogs, those evildoers, those mutilators of the flesh." He was talking about Jewish legalists who were taking the gospel and adding to it that you also had to follow the law and be circumcised and go through all these steps, when it's just faith in the gospel and believing in what Jesus did for you that saves you. It's funny that Paul used the term dogs in this passage, because that's what the Jewish people used to refer to the non-Jewish Gentiles as. So he was kind of giving themselves a taste of their own medicine. These dogs that Paul was referring to were also called Judaizers, and they were adding to what was necessary for salvation. So Paul went on to kind of brag about his background as a Jewish person. He said, "Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church. As for righteousness, based on the law, faultless." Paul would probably have been considered one of the most righteous Jewish people in that time. But after Paul was knocked off of his horse on that road to Damascus and his life was totally transformed by Jesus, he realized that he could no longer have any confidence in all those things that he thought were so good before. All of those things that Paul thought were so good and righteous, he realized were keeping him from a personal relationship with the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Paul encourages his friends to forget about what's behind them and press on into the future. He says, "I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." Finally, in chapter 4, Paul talks about the marks of a Christian life, which are joy and peace. He says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things." So it turns out that Paul did some of his best work while he was in prison. I think about 4 books of the Bible were written by Paul while he was in prison. And yet he displayed a joy that could never be dictated by what was going on around him, because the joy was on the inside in his heart, like it is for so many of us. The world would want us to think that we would need enough money or a good job or good relationships and a healthy family to be happy. But what Paul is telling us will bring joy are things like praying for others, caring about others more than you care about yourself, serving others, humbling yourself, and finding your strength in the Lord and not your own flesh, or you're having confidence in you being a good person. And that might sound crazy or backwards to some of us, but I can literally testify that it's so true, because even as I was discouraged this week, all it took was some prayer and remembering that that joy never leaves my heart. That just looking forward to those little things like that cup of coffee or sunrise or special time with Jesus brings me so much joy. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are so amazing, and we just glorify your name today and give you all the praise and honor and thanks for everything you do in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for the joy that you provide that cannot be changed by whatever's happening in our lives. The joy of the Lord will be our strength. And Lord, I just pray for anybody listening right now that does feel like a prisoner, just like Paul was in prison when he wrote this epistle. I pray that you would spark that joy in their heart, or line up circumstances to give them a way to move past whatever that is. And as we continue to put you first and pray for others and serve others, and as we humble ourselves, I just pray that that joy wells up inside of us. And we just ask all of this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. If you guys have any questions or comments for me, please leave them in the comments below. And if you would like to subscribe, that would be awesome. And I'm going to continue praying for you guys like I always do. It might seem like to talk about joy and difficulty seems like an oxymoron, but it's just one of the wonderful things that I love about the Lord. Take care, stay safe and well, and I'll see you next week.